Narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvasi. Gajananam bhutaganati sevitam kapitta jambu palasara bhakshitam umasatam loka vinashakaranam samami vigneshara bada pankajam apadam vartaram dataram sarvatam padam loka viramam shri ramam huyo huyo namamiham artaram artihantaram bhitanam bhayanajanam tishatam kaladandam tapnamachandram namamiham Ramaya Nama Badraya Ramachandraya Vedase Raghunathaya Nathaya Sitaya Hamadaya Namah Kujandam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhurakaram Arogya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Valmike Munijengmasya Kavita Vanacharina Shrungan Rama Gatanadam Koneyati Paramgatim Kushpadigata Varesham Madhigigata Rakhradam Ramaya Nama Amada Nilatpajam Anjananandanam Viram Janaki Shoganashanam Kapishamakshantaram Vandiranka Bhayankaram Mangal Bhavan Amangal Hari Mangal Bhavan Amangal Hari Hanuman Gosai Jay 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 Hanuman Gosai Krupa Karu Guru Devaki Nai Krupa Karu Guru Devaki Nai Jay Jay Hanuman Gosai Mangal Bhavan Amangal Hari Janak Suta Jag Janani Janaki Atishaya Priya Karuna Nidhanaki Chake Jugpad Kamal Mana Jasukrupa Nirmal Mati Pahu So we were in the beginning of Uttara Kanda where Maharishis, Saptarishis, great rishis from the north, the south, the east and the west have all arrived to the court of Rama, Raja Rama. The greatest of the rishis, Agastya onwards, have all come there. And Rama has received them with all reverence. And they are all seated in the hall of Rama. He has made kind inquiries. They have replied in happiness. And they have explained to him their supreme satisfaction that the great Rama has decimated Ravana and all the great Rakshasa-s. And in that course of that, conversation, which Agastya is actually speaking on behalf of all the rishis, conveying their blessings and gratitude to Rama, he mentions that for Rama to have decimated all the Rakshasas is not a big deal, not such a big thing for him. But then these Rakshasas are so great, etc. And then he says that the greatest satisfaction we got was actually the slaying of Indrajit. And Rama was suitably surprised, and he had asked with all humility, he had questioned Agastya and asked him as to what the reason was that Indrajit was being placed even higher than Ravana and Kumbhakarna and all the other terrific Rakshasas. He says, yes, Indrajit was well known to have been a very great warrior. He has defeated Indra himself, but what is it that made him superior to his own father, who himself had no peer? And if the matter, the reason is not a secret, Lord, please, if it may be shared with me, then I submit with all humility. I would like to know, is what he had asked Agastya. And Agastya has said, we shall tell you, Rama, that reason, but before we get to that, we shall tell you the, let me start with the genesis of Ravana himself. Where did he come from? Thereby starts, the seed is sown for the great series of stories of Uttara Kanda. Which is full of stories. +110 chapters in Uttara Kanda. So Agastya starts telling him the story of the genesis of Ravana. He says, in the far past, O king, in Krita Yuga, Satya Yuga, there lived a Brahmana sage rishi of name Pulastya. He was the powerful son of Brahma. He was Brahma's alter ego, as it were. His virtues, stemming from his nature, his innate nature, are far too numerous to mention. Okay. Suffice it to say that he was the son of Brahma. That should give you an idea of what he was. Brahma Tejo Balam Balam. Pulastya, the great sage, lived a dharmic life and was staying in the ashram of Rishi Trinabindu on the flanks of the mountain Meru. Trinabindu means humility itself. Trina is grass, Bindu is dot. Pulastya the sage, he is Brahma's son. So Vedas are his breath itself. So along with adhyayana of the Veda, subduing his senses, he was practicing tapasya in the ashram of Tirubindu, in the flanks of the mountain Meru. Just before I came here, I happened to see a picture of one of the Nayanmars. It's called Rudra Pashupatiya. The picture is nice, it catches eye. He's standing underwater, I mean, he's standing in river water or tank, or temple tank water or whatever. Just his head is out and his hands are out and he's like that, up till here, up to the neck he's standing. And the story is that every morning at dawn and then evening at dusk, that is a particular village temple is still there. In that temple he used to, Shiva's temple, he will enter the tank water and then he'll chant the Rudram with absolute focus and concentration every day. And then Shiva gave him his salvation. Rudra Pashupatiya. As if it's an alternate reality of all these temples exist in Ravana. With real sages, real literature, everything. What does it say? So like that, if we can say that in the Kali Yugam, there was a Rudra Pashupatiya. Krita Yugam, the Pulastya. Was practicing tapasya in the and Veda Dhyana in the ashrama of Tirubindu in Mount Meru. You see, this business of karma, who does it lead? Everybody is a package of karma. So you see a person, you see some karma working. So you have a choice. You can get caught in that karma or not caught in that karma. Pulastya. He may be who he is. He was there. And he had a like we have loud music. Sometimes some auto will park and loud music will start near your house. Like that he had a problem. He was doing his tapasya in the ashrama. This, you know, pannagas and the royal sages, Radha Rishis, Rishis, etc. Some of their daughters, unmarried daughters. They used to just come off to this ashrama of Tirubindu. They'll come there. And that was a disturbance for him. Apsaras will come with him. Apsaras will come. Apsaras were looking for some diversions. New place to picnic kind of thing. And this place in Mount Meru was pleasant all year round. Very nice place, all that, lovely place. So these girls used to go there to play. So Valmiki says, Agastya is telling to Rama, the innocent girls used to come there and they would play and dance and sing and all that. They were happy, but it was disturbing his tapasya. And, well, Veda is Veda. So he was in Veda Dhyana. Whatever it was, some part of a Dhyana that he was doing. So he kind of announced to them that, listen, See, if you continue to come here, then there is a problem. If you come here, whoever the girl may be, she will become pregnant. He announced it. He's chanting. He's doing something. Some Veda there. Some Veda is chanting. He's saying, well, the power, this will happen. No. He announced that too. Yes. Just fled. All of them fled. Not one coming here. This cantankerous rishi is here. It's the problem. So they just went. They left. No, this was not known. Trinabindu's daughter. Trinabindu himself, whose ashrama it was. He has a daughter also. So maybe she was the binding force for all these girls to come there. Who knows? So she didn't know. She said, where have nobody has come today, etc. She must have got ready, looked around, nobody's come. Must have decided today we'll do this dance or whatever. Nobody has come. So she went hunting around, where are they? And she was there. So whatever she did, she managed to disturb him. He was chanting the Veda at that time. And the frantic search for her friends in such diversions, she landed there and suddenly she was pregnant. She didn't know what happened to her, but she knows something has happened. It was not, she didn't know, I mean it was not some of the, it was not, she didn't, she had no clarity at what, but she knew. Her complexion had undergone a change, pallor had come. So she was frightened. So she quickly went back to her house. And her father landed up, maybe he was surprised to see her earlier than usual, she is at home, but he saw her, she was there. And he knew that she's not looking good, there's something amiss. He looked at her and then said, what happened? What caused this change? There's a change in you. What caused it? She folded her hands to her father and said, I don't know what has happened, but I had gone to the presence of the sage Pulastya, who has realized the self, the sage. And I was looking for my playmates. None of my playmates I found, they had not come there. But then after I had gone there, my appearance has undergone this change and I am in great fright and I have come here. Trinabindu, who was himself effulgent because of his own tapasya, he probably looked into her eye and he knew what had happened. And he realized this is what has happened. So he said, come with me. He took her hand and took her to sage Pulastya and said, blessed sage, I want to do Kanyadhanam of this daughter to you. She has good qualities. She will be devoted to you. She will be your aid in your constant practice of tapasya. Pulastya, too, knows the play of karma, he said. May that be so. That is good. Very good. So, all due rights, the daughter was given away to him. And Trinabindu relieved. Father, he came back.
karma has been passed, passed on.
So she lived now with her husband, Pulastya, pleasing him by his her qualities, impeccable conduct. His tapasya was nirvignam. Everything was perfect. The great sage Pulastya was very pleased and he told her, you will have a son who will be my equal. He will continue the lineage, he will be known as Pulastya. Because he was conceived when you heard me chant the Vedas. His name will be Vishravas. Because of Shravana. Mantra Shakti. The Mantra Shakti can create the entire universe. Can it not create a Vishravas? Vishravas. She was delighted to hear about it and before long she gave birth to her son Vishravas, who had an innate mastery of the Vedas, and as he grew up he had all the good qualities as said, as predicted, as foretold by his father. He possessed that rare quality of equipoise. He was devoted to vrata, devoted to the practice of good. He was as zealous in the practice of tapasya as his father. Vataputra pulastyasya vishrava muni pungava achirenaiva kalena piteva tapasisthita. So in a short time, in not too long a time, he became as eminent in tapasya as his own father. What were his qualities? Satyavan, Shilavan, Danta, Swadhyaya Nirata, Shuchi, Sarvabhogeshu Samsakto, Nityam Dharma Parayana. Satyavan, he was that firm in adherence to truth. Shilavan, extremely pleasing good conduct. Danta, control, self-control, mind and senses. Swadhyaya Nirata, very, very sincere and rigorous in the practice of Veda Dhyanam. Shuchi, pure. Sarvabhogeshu Samsakto, unattached, unconcerned, unattached to any kind of sensual pleasure, any kind of enjoyment. Nityam Dharma Parayana, eternally, totally, constantly devoted to Dharma. So, admirable boy. One Rishi was looking out for such a boy. So, the great sage Bharadwaja Bharadwaja Gotra we will find all over India, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. Bharadwaja, he had a daughter, a divinely beautiful daughter called Deva Varni. So he gave his daughter in marriage to Vishravas. They had a beautiful son. So Pulastya was now a grandfather. Pulastya rejoiced at his grandson's birth and he foresaw thanks to his tapobala, that his grandson will become the guardian of wealth, the lord of wealth. So for his naming ceremony, all the sages had come and Pulastya named him, his grandson. He gave him the name Vaishravana, Vishravas' son, by which he would become famous in the days to come. Vaishravana did not take too long to decide that the place to go is Tapovana. The penitential woods, he went there and started doing tapasya and started rapidly advancing in tapasya like a fire into which oblations are being made. That is tapa, japa. It is of oblations being made into the fire. So he was living alone and he decided what his mission is going to be. Charishye paramam dharma, dharmo hi paramagati. This young Vaishravana decided that I will walk the path of dharma, parama dharma, because dharma is the highest goal. So he decided to do tapasya and tapasya alone, and he imposed upon himself the greatest of discipline. He started for 1,000 years. He lived only on water. Then for the next 1,000 years lived only on air. Then for the next 1,000 years lived on nothing. When thousands of years had thus passed as if it was no more than a year, this time is a very difficult concept. It can be different in physical clock, different in experience, all are possible. So when thousands of years had passed as if there were no more than a year, Brahma of marvelous power, he came to him along with Indra, etc., and told my child, he told Vaishravana, my child, I am very pleased with you. Ask for any boon that you may like. All will be well with you. Indeed, you are worthy of every boon and any boon that you can think of. Vaishravana now, so many thousands of years of tapasya, and the boon giver is in front of him, told him that, O Pitamaha, I would like to be one of the guardians of the world. I would like to be the custodian of the wealth. Brahma rejoiced to hear this, it seems. He absolutely rejoiced to hear this, and he said, I have been contemplating to appoint the fourth guardian. I have three already, Yama for the south, Indra for the east, Varuna for the west. And I have been wanting to appoint a fourth guardian for the north. It is just the position that you yourself are desirous of. Therefore, you who know all dharma, you shall be the lord of wealth. You will be the fourth guardian of the world along with Indra and Varuna and Yama. And I also give you this aerial vehicle Pushpaka Vimana, which is as bright as the sun. I give it to you as your vehicle. This giving vehicle as perquisite since that time. Suddenly, you know, top level executives in front of Mercedes will be standing. Oh, where did they give him 60 lakhs? What did he do? Why did he give him all that? Vehicle. The wretched road is saying, vehicle. So, Brahma gave him vehicle also. Be careful when people give you things. Hey, gave it. So he said, keep this vehicle also. And may all be good with you. All good be with you. I now bid you farewell. With these two bones that I have given you, my own work has been fulfilled. It's like having taken a great trouble of taking something, putting it in the position, they can push it, now things will take its course, like that. Now, my own work has been fulfilled. Fourth guardian he had not had, so that must have been weighing on his head. Now that is also now closed, now I can go back to my tapasya, whatever, he's happy. So now you have a lot of wealth. So he went to his father, told him, this is all. And then he said, Father, the great Pitama has given me everything, but he has not given me a place of residence. But he has given me whatever I desired most. But what do you think? Please think of some suitable place where I can stay without causing injury to anybody else. The great sage said, listen, I'll tell you. On the far south, the southern ocean, there is a mountain called Trikuta. On the top of this mountain is situated the beautiful city of Lanka, which is as spacious as Mahendra's Amaravati. It was built by Vishwakarma for the Rakshasas to live in. As Amaravati was built for Mahendra. Without a doubt, you can live there and may all be well with you. It is enclosed, this great city of Lanka is enclosed by a rampart of gold and a moat, and it is furnished with mechanical engines of destruction and other weapons. It is a delightful city with arched gateways of gold, lapis lazuli. Lanka was abandoned in the far past by Rakshasas from the fear of Vishnu and is now totally free from Rakshasa hordes who have all gone to Rasatala. That Lanka is deserted and it has no master. You may go there, my son, and you can live in comfort. stay, no, no, that bungalow of mine is there. Nobody is there. Why don't you go and stay there like that? I was asking my friend, he's come from America to get his daughter married. We are from a classmate. The daughter was married in Chettinad, the ancestral house and all. Nice pictures. Facebook page, good thing. So like that. So he came, I said, anybody is there? Will you be staying there in that house? He said, my parents are still there. I said, yeah, somebody is there. But it's there. The ancestral house is there. One day maybe his grandson may come and stay there. Don't know. Like that, it may be empty. Like that, it is empty. It also belongs to Rakshasa-s. So, told him, you go there. No problem for you. You can stay there. And there will be nothing wrong in your living there. Nobody will be inconvenienced by it. Etc. So he went to Lanka. And apparently thousands of Rakshasa-s then came there. They were all pleased with the prospect of living there. Within a short time, it became exceedingly prosperous. And Vaishravana was living there happily in Lanka, which had the whole sea as the moat all around. In time to time, he had Pushpakaman. Time to time, he would go and visit his father, mother, etc. Come back to Lanka. A good time. The guardian of the north, but is living in the south. There. It's all right. I mean, he had to go north later. Yeah. Initially, he decided I'll work from here. It's like people say, I'll work from home. Like, office is somewhere. So he was sent. There he was. Now, tata shira kampayitva tretagni samavigraham tamagastyam muhur drishtva smayamano bhyabhashata. Rama was listening to the story. Tata shira kampayitva, when he heard this so far, he started shaking his head like this. Tretagni samavigraham, he was like three agnis, his big head, like fire, he was jolchifying, and his head was shaking, and with a smile, smayamano, with a smile on his face, he went on looking at Agastya, and the question was there. He had to ask that question now. So he asked him. And he said, you mentioned that Rakshasa-s had abandoned Lanka in the far past. I was astonished to hear that, in that part of it. Earlier itself, some Rakshasa-s had stayed there in Lanka. I in fact thought, it was my opinion, my belief that all Rakshasa-s had come from the family of Pulastya. Now you have mentioned that Pulastya's grandson was given Lanka, where earlier itself Rakshasa-s had stayed and they had all gone to. Who are these Rakshasa-s? Who are these Rakshasa-s? Were they stronger than Ravana and Kumbhakarna and Vikata and Prahastha and Indrajit? For what offense were they driven away from there by Mahavishnu? Please tell me about it. O blameless one, and dispel my doubt like the sun dissipates darkness. Agastya. Valmiki says, rather surprised to hear these choice and apt words from Raghava, but he answered, hey, I'll tell you. In the far past, Brahma the progenitor, having created the waters first, he was reborn in the lotus on those waters.
And he created many beings for the protection of these waters. There are bunch of them, whole lot of them. And apparently many of them were oppressed by hunger and thirst also. They were there. So they were there. See, they were being created. Now they want something to do. They want to do something. Right? People want something to do. So it's a problem. So they went to Brahma and they asked him, what shall we do? So he told them with an encouraging smile, you should protect these waters with utmost vigilance. Total vigilance. So a bunch of them said, we shall protect them. But a bunch of them were very hungry. They said, we shall consume them. So in Sanskrit, a bunch of them said, Rakshama. Another bunch of them said, Yakshama. So those who said, Rakshama, we shall protect them, became Rakshasas. Those of you, Brahma told them, those of you who said Rakshama shall become Rakshasas. Those of you who said Yakshama will become Yakshas. So now these Rakshasas. So among these Rakshasas are two brothers, Heti and Praheti. They were the equals of Madhu and Kaitava. They are the rulers of Rakshasas. Heti and Praheti, brothers. Praheti was dharmic person, Rakshasa. He entered into Tapovana to do tapasya. He was clear about his life mission. He said, I'll do tapasya. So he went off to do tapasya. No, Praheti. Heti was also clear about his life mission. He wanted to get married. So he made great efforts on this point. And then he got married to the sister of Yama. Her name was Bhaya. Fear. Yama's sister. Very desperate man. So he married Bhaya. Sister of Yama. It's good. Better to get married to sister of Yama. Why not? So, he'll not kill him, at least son-in-law. So brother-in-law, Yama, Bhaya. Bhaya. Yama was dreaded by all, but no, he was the one. So he married Bhaya. Heti. Apparently, Heti, he was the best of fathers, it seems. He got a son. The best of fathers. Raksha, very good Raksha father. He got a son named Vidyutkesha. Named Vidyutkesha means lightning hair. Instead of hair, lightning becomes a boy, baby. See, Vidyutkesha, Raksha. Heti's son. He grew quickly like a rain cloud, it seems. Vidyutkesha. And became a marriageable age. So his father had to busy himself finding a wife for him. So he went and he solicited on behalf of his son. The daughter of Sandhya. Sandhya's daughter was great. And Agastya told Rama, Sandhya, reflecting that her daughter has to be given to somebody or the other. Somebody or the other, he bestowed her on Vidyutkesha. Vidyutkesha, theek hai. So, Vidyutkesha, she came. Vidyutkesha, her name was Salakatankata. Salakatankata. That was her name. Good question. Answer is there. Salakatankata. So Vidyutkesha and Salakatankata, they were married. she got pregnant. She went to Mandara mountain to deliver her child. A child was born, a son, with luster of rain cloud. Nice looking baby boy. And Agastya said she bore a son even as Ganga brought forth the child whom the fire god had deposited in her. Like that, she sala katangata brought forth the child. But she was a lady of clear mind. So what she did, she abandoned that child there, in that Mandara mountain. You to your karma, I to mine. So she abandoned that child there and went back to Delhi with Vidyutkesha again and forgot about the child. So that child was abandoned in that mountain Mandara. God bless you, went off. Now this abandoned child was there in the mountain. So the child started crying, oh, and all that, baby. And it was putting the fist into its mouth and crying, it is. Loudly crying. Tato vrishabhamasthaya parvatya sahita shiva vayumargena gachanve shushravaruditasvanam. So the baby who was crying, nobody will hear, God will hear. So when the child was crying like this, on the Vrishabha, that is Nandikesha, Parvati was going with Shiva. Both of them were traveling. Vayu Magena, in the highway of the sky. And they, Shushrava, Ruditasram, they heard this loud wailing cry from the mountain below. So this baby, there, and Shiva and Parvati, they saw this baby. Parvati must have said, we have to do something about it. So Shiva had to do, they came down and Shiva, he does what will please you, Parvati. So what he did is that he thought this may take time, so he wanted to make it slightly faster so that they can proceed with life. So what he did, he made the Raksha child quickly the same age as his mother. So the baby suddenly became same age as Sala Katangata. Why you not going to ask me? That's the story. One child was there, it was crying, moved by pity. Parvati and Shiva came, and God knows what all Parvati might have wanted to do. Shiva decided we'll do a good job about it. He made that boy into a tall, same age as Sala Katangata. Now he can take care of himself. I mean, like that he had made. Mahadeva. Mahadeva, who knows neither change nor rain. He also made this boy immortal. He gave him a city that will float, fly in the sky for this baby. All this from his desire to please Parvati. Desire to please Parvati. Just give. So he gave. Whatever, just give. Otherwise, we don't know. What should we ask? So he gave. And city that flies in the sky also. So ciao. So all that was done for him. This baby didn't know what luck was going to do. I mean, mother abandoned him, but God spoiled him. Umaya pivaro datto rakshasanam nripatmaja sadyo paladhir garbhasya prasuti sadyevaja sadyeva yaprati matureva vayasamam. But you know, if Shankara thought that Parvati was done with it, he doesn't know Parvati yet. He doesn't know Parvati yet. She's thinking as the situation develops. So quickly, Shiva thought it changed the landscape, age, he gave immortality, float in the sky, all that he had given. So shall we proceed? So Parvati said, no, hold a minute. You have to. It's not complete. Said something. We have to properly round this. Finishing touches have to be given. Border has to be. All that has to be done. So those things. So she said, she gave on her own. She bestowed on the Rakshasa race, the entire Rakshasa race, a boon. The boon of instant pregnancy and instant delivery, as well as the attainment by the child at the moment of the birth or the same age as the mother. All that. Parvati said, Rakshasa race. Chal. She said, instant pregnancy, instant delivery. As soon as it's born, same age as a mother. Kya matlab natak rata rakha, we'll do all this. So this Parvati said, Deya, done. Meanwhile, our man had taken the city and he was flying in the sky. Gone. Sukesha. His name was Sukesha. He was waxing proud by the reason of the boon that he had got, immortality. Everything was there, immortality. Born with a fist in the mouth, however, all of that. Now, mighty Sukesha, his powerful intellect, he was like Purandara, he could go wherever he wanted, he had a moving aerial city, life was good. On that note, we'll conclude here and proceed from here. Maybe week after next, I think.
हर नमः पार्वती पतये
हर नमः महादेव
जानकी कांत स्मरणं
जय जय राम राम
गोपिका जीवन स्मरणं
गोविंदा गोविंदा
दिल मुरुगनक
हर हर हर
सद्गुरु स्वामिनः
जय